Well, let's turn to 1 Peter chapter 4. We will be finishing this chapter, and we are coming to an unpopular subject in America, Christian persecution. No one wants to talk about that. Very few churches do talk about it. There's probably a couple reasons. One, there's a sense that because we are so blessed and we have so much freedom here that it almost seems irrelevant. I mean, you know, why would we talk about that? That doesn't really apply to us, does it? Well, that's one possibility. Another possibility is it's kind of difficult as we read about God's will in persecution. It goes against so much that we hear today. And so we're going to look at these verses. Understand that the theme of suffering has been interwoven by Peter throughout this letter. But he's not talking here about any sort of what we might call general suffering because of the fallen world in which we live. This is not the suffering that comes from the tragic loss of a loved one, or from a horrible illness, or from a financial difficulty, or losing your home in a hurricane or a tornado. This is about specifically persecution because you are a follower of Jesus Christ. So we begin by studying this divine persecution. That's what I mean by that when I say divine. And starting with our readiness in verse 12 of chapter 4. Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you. Now, how America needs this. I just feel that there are so many people that if Christian persecution came our way, they would say, hey, I didn't sign up for this. I mean, this wasn't what I was promised when I went forward at that altar call. What's going on? And yet, when we read the New Testament, when we read Jesus himself, when the crowds were following him, it was like he almost went out of his way to discourage people from following him. Remember, he turned to the crowds and he'd say, if you want to follow me, pick up your cross, deny yourself. And we're told that many did in fact turn away and stopped following him. It seemed to be that's what he wanted, because he wanted us to understand of the cost in following him. And then, of course, in the book of Acts, when you see the apostles preaching the gospel, they're not preaching some wealth and prosperity nonsense. They're preaching forgiveness of sins in the name of Jesus Christ. They're preaching repentance. And again, that's why we come to Christ. And it's not just some sort of state of mind that we want to, you know, ease our conscience. Oh, good, I'm forgiven. No, it's about truth. It's about the fact that there is a true and living God who created us, and we are responsible to, and one day we will stand before, and we have offended because of our sins. But this God is loving, he is gracious, he is merciful, and he desires us to enjoy his presence and his glory for all eternity. And so he's made the remedy through Jesus Christ that all who would come to him through Christ would be saved. And that's the message. But that doesn't mean that we're immune from this persecution. So be ready for it. Don't think it's strange when it comes your way. And now he talks about our rejoicing. Verse 13, rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. When Jesus appeared to Paul, back when he was still known as Saul of Tarsus, he said, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? And Saul said, who are you, Lord? I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom you are persecuting. And yet when we read Acts, we realize, well, wait a minute, Saul was persecuting Christians, yes. But Jesus had already ascended to heaven. How is it that he was persecuting Jesus himself? And what, of course, we recognize is that Jesus personalizes and identifies with his church. To persecute the Christian is to persecute Jesus himself. And our recognition of that fact is important. So verse 14, if you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. On their part, he is blasphemed, but on your part, he is glorified. So the persecution, the reproach, is directed at Christ, even though it comes to us. So really, from their perspective, they're blaspheming God. But what Peter says is it shows that God's Spirit is resting upon you. Or to put another way, if you're some sort of a worldly, backslidden, carnal Christian, you know, you're not going to face a lot of persecution from the world. You're just swimming along right with them, aren't you? But all who will live godly in Christ Jesus, they will suffer persecution. And so we understand that. We have that recognition. But at the same time, now there's a reminder in verse 15. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or as a busybody or a meddler in other people's matters. So Christian, it is not up to you to take justice in your own hands and decide that that abortion doctor performing abortions in the third trimester doesn't deserve to live because he's a murderer, and to execute him. Don't suffer as a murderer. Don't suffer as a thief. Don't think just because you read in some professing Christian newsletter that somehow income taxes are optional and you know, you don't have to pay them, and the government wastes our money on all these sinful projects, so don't pay them. And no. And by the way, if you've heard that and you believe that, we need to talk, because I've studied all those arguments. They're ridiculous. They absolutely do not have any legal weight whatsoever. And if you ever make any money, you'll get caught and you'll be in jail. Now, that's stealing. Pay taxes to who we owe taxes. By the way, it's also stealing when you're on the job and your employer is paying you to do work and you're spending that time, well, I'm going to witness to my coworker here. We're going to talk scripture and we're going to do that. Well, that's stealing from your boss. You do that at the lunch hour. Do that after work. Don't suffer as a thief. Don't suffer as an evildoer. You know, they fired me. Why'd they fire you? Well, I think it's because I'm a Christian. Now, they said that they found, you know, porn on my office computer, but I mean, I think it's because I'm a Christian. No, it's because you're an evildoer. And of course, the church doesn't have any problem with gossip and meddling, right? I mean, that's not an issue we don't have. You see, we live in a time where, unfortunately, if one is critical of a point of view, an issue of some sort that might speak to the black community, the Hispanic community, the Asian community, rather than hearing your point of view and your perspective, just, you're a racist. You're a racist. That's all. Just dismissive. Now, racism is a vile evil. It's one of the most evil things that humanity has in its existence. True racism. And it's a terrible insult to call someone a racist. I'm insulted if someone calls me a racist, but the word gets thrown around so much now in debate that it's losing its meaning in many ways. And that's an insult to true racism, isn't it? I grew up in Glendale. In Glendale, when I was growing up, there were very, very few black people that lived there. And I only found out later when I got older, it was because there was a time there when a black family would move into the town that they would kind of get harassed a little bit, and they would typically move out. And kind of word spread that you might want to go to Pasadena or Altadena if you want to kind of get in that area and not Glendale. And my first fight, sixth grade, we had a new kid at school. You know how tough it is when you join a school in sixth grade. And he was black. He's the only black kid in the school. And there was a fight between him and one of the other guys, and I tried to break it up, and I got beat up. But I have always despised racism, even before I was a Christian, from the time I was a little kid. And why am I talking about this? Because, again, Christians who suffer because they are thieves or meddlers or evildoers, and then say, oh, it's just because I'm a Christian. They're just persecuting me because I'm a Christian. They are doing a disservice to what true Christian persecution is all about. What our true brothers and sisters around the world experience in the name of Christ. And so if you're a flake on the job and your employer is on you because you're not working and that's what he's paying you for, and then you say, well, it's just because I'm a Christian. That's why he's upset. No. You're guilty of this verse.